Extend a warm welcome to you this morning. We pray and trust as you worship with us, you'll be drawn closer to the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and closer to us as a community of faith, a church family. We just have to do an announcement about next Sunday's congregational meeting. By law, you're required to announce that 2 Sundays in a row, and it's also in the newsletter. Right after worship next Sunday, there'll be a congregational meeting and a vote on the budget for 2021. And for council members as well. We have 6 people that have stepped up and said they want to be on the council for 3 spots. So you can also, if you don't come to worship, you can drive through and get a ballot, and that way you don't have to see or talk to anybody. Fill out that ballot and drive to the ballot box. I will be a poll watcher, so there will be no ballot stuffing for sure. And particularly people from Michigan, I'm suspect of, and Las Vegas, Nevada. That also raises some. Sandy, I don't know, you got some family out there. But anyway, all right. And also Nancy Gary asked me to announce that she's in charge of Secret Sisters in 2021, and there's a form in the back. Fill that out and get that to Nancy by January 10th. And Don McFarland, I see that hand up. God bless you, brother.
Just to let you know, there's a copy of Home's Budget back here. We'd like you to take home and read it. If you have any questions, please give myself or Patrick a call. We can answer them for you. Proposed budget that we're doing, we actually proposing a $40 change, raising it by $40. And we really cut down a lot on that stuff. So if you have any questions, please, it's back here so you can take a look at it and be prepared for next week.
And also my understanding is Patrick Barrett is going to have a Zoom meeting.
Yes.
On Saturday at 10 and 2, I think.
I think it's 10 and 2.
And so contact Patrick if you want to be in part of that Zoom meeting. I'll be in part of that as well. And you can ask any questions that you have then. And Patrick will go over that. And it shouldn't take long, to be honest. Just a minor raise or two.
Right.
All righty. Well, let's all stand for our call to worship. This is the Sunday of Peace, the Peace Camp.
As it was in the
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, love of our Heavenly Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We gather this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us, but if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us take a brief moment and ask the Holy Spirit to show us where we fall short of God's standard of holiness, confess those sins, and receive the forgiveness that we have in the shed blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Small hand reaching out.
Advent is a time to watch.
We watch and hope for the Lord.
Oh, come, Emmanuel. During Advent, we watch with hope in the midst of despair.
We watch in hope for the Lord. Oh, come, Emmanuel.
During Advent, we watch for forgiveness in the midst of rebellion.
We watch in hope for the Lord. Oh, come, Emmanuel.
During Advent, we watch for peace in the midst of conflict.
We watch in hope for the Lord. Oh, come, Emmanuel.
During Advent, we watch for the presence of God in the midst of a fallen world.
We watch in hope for the Lord. Oh, come, Emmanuel.
This morning, we light two candles. The first candle reminds us of the time of waiting. We wait in anticipation for God to fulfill every promise set forth in the Bible. The second candle reminds us that Advent is also a time of watching. We watch with expectant eyes, trusting that God is active, present, and consistently at work, leading all of creation toward the plan of redemption. As we light the second candle, we ask for faith to watch for God's presence and open eyes to see all that God is doing. Expectation. Open our eyes that we might see the ways you are at work around us, within us, and through us. Amen.
Power on.
Today is a dove holding an olive branch in its mouth. The dove represents the Holy Spirit, and it also represents peace. Luther's Small Catechism points out that the Bible tells us that the Holy Spirit descended upon Jesus like a dove when he was baptized. Extending an olive branch is a gesture of peace. We now have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and intercession. With thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. Children, please come forward to place your chrismon ornaments of peace on the chrismon tree.
Be of God, O God.
time. If anybody is having trouble, don't hesitate to sit down. That's perfectly okay. The gospel this morning is from Mark, the first chapter, verses 1 through 8. Hear the word of the Lord. The beginning of the good news about Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet. I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way. A voice of one calling in the wilderness. Prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight paths for him. And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. John wore clothing made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And this was his message. After me comes the one more powerful than I, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
This morning, the sermon text is from 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 14. Hear the word of the Lord. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he's patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire. And the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with this promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth, where righteousness dwells. So then, dear friends, since you're looking forward to this, make every effort to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with him. The word of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Well, a Jewish lady named Mrs. Rosenberg, many years ago, was stranded late one night at a fashionable resort, and one that did not admit Jewish people. The desk clerk looked down at the book and said, "Sorry, no room, the hotel is full." The Jewish lady said, "But your sign says that you have vacancies." The desk clerk stammered and then said curtly, "You know that we do not admit Jews. Now if you will try the other side of town." Mrs. Rosenberg stiffened noticeable and said, "Oh, let me know I converted to your religion." The desk clerk said, "Oh, yeah? Let me give you a little test. How was Jesus born?" Mrs. Rosenberg said, "He was born to a virgin named Mary in a little town called Bethlehem." "Very good," replied the hotel clerk. "Tell me more." She said, "Well, he was born in a manger." "That's right," said the hotel clerk. "And why was he born in a manger?" Mrs. Rosenberg replied very loudly, "Because a jerk like you in the hotel wouldn't give a Jewish lady a room for the night." Thank you. Sometimes they don't work, you know. Mary, Joseph, and the soon-to-be Messiah certainly had to wait for a room in Bethlehem that cold, cold night. I bet Mary and Joseph were growing a bit impatient while they tried to find a place to stay. "Don't you and I get impatient when we have to wait? We live in a microwave world, don't we? We shouldn't have to wait for anything. I get bothered when my laptop struggles to, boot up. let alone having to wait 90 seconds for a bag of rice to cook for my kids. And then when I pull it up, I'm in such a rush to get it open, I scald my hands because it's so stinking hot. But don't we hate waiting at the doctor's office? Is that not just the worst? First you check in, then you go to a room with a little or no current periodicals. Or if they see kids there, you can catch up on the latest episode of Cartoon Network. And don't you watch for the door to be opened by your doctor's nurse? Unfortunately, I go to a clinic where there's a lot of docs, and so chances are it's not my doc's nurse opening the door to call my name. It's an exercise in patience for sure, which I could use. Nothing I really need, but I pray, all right, Lord, if you must make me more like Jesus, okay. So I wait and watch, trying to think of things to do. I work through my unread emails, discarding those I have no reason to receive, like those telling me to click to see the yachts athletes and movie stars have. When I run out of emails, I always go through my pictures and discard all the pictures my kids have taken of walls, floors, ceilings, dogs, cats, and a million other things. Why do I have 682 pictures? I only took four. But guess what? Once the nurse comes out, now I'm even in a smaller room with less to read except for height and weight charts. That's depressing, of course. And then there's charts in my circulatory system or something worse. And by now my phone has died. Claustrophobia sets in and I begin to wonder why I set up the appointment in the first place. So far going to the doc hasn't been a peaceful experience. It's been full of anxiety and apprehension. Eventually somebody sees me that can write scripts and order x-rays or blood work and my fears and anxiety subside. But what do we do if the wait time exceeds the short-term ways to handle it? Like what if the wait time's 2,000 years or more? That would be us. Those in our sermon text this morning, 2 Peter 3, 8-14, hadn't waited 2,000 years for Jesus' second advent. But it must have felt like it to them. Why do I say that? Well, we see Peter warning the dispersed Christians here in 2 Peter that above all, they must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, "Where is this coming he promised? Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation." These scoffers, who are false teachers as well, contend that everything is going on as usual. They make fun of Jesus' promise of his return and essentially live any way they want because he's not coming back anytime soon. Peter described them in the second chapter as blots and blemishes, reveling in their deceptions while they take part in the agape feast that the Christians had and the Lord's Supper. They had eyes full of adultery, insatiable for sin. They enticed unsteady souls. They had hearts trained for greed. They were accursed children, forsaking the right way. They have gone astray, Peter says. He goes on to say they're waterless springs and mist driven by a storm. For them, the gloom of utter darkness has been reserved for speaking loud boasts of folly. They entice by sensual passions of the flesh those who are barely escaping from those who live in error. They promise them freedom, but they themselves are slaves of corruption. For whatever overcomes a person, to that he is enslaved. What has caused these scoffers who apparently professed Christ to go astray? Peter attributes their lack of godly living to not remembering and believing the words of the prophets and the apostles about Jesus' return. So they live any way they want, but genuine believers do not live that way. Yes, we all commit sins of omission and commission, but we don't like the fact that we do. We know we're both saints justified by faith in Christ alone and sinners who don't keep the law of loving the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength and our neighbors as ourselves perfectly. Consequently, we're to repent daily, as Martin Luther said, and remember our baptisms. That we're new creatures in Christ, that we have the Holy Spirit who empowers us to live godly lives. Peter goes on to remind the scattered believers that to the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like a day. So he is not slow to fulfill his promise, and as some count slowness, but is patient toward them and us, not wishing any to perish, but that all should reach repentance. The Lord wants everyone to change their minds about Jesus, that he is the Messiah, God's promised who saves us, God's anointed one, promised one, who saved us by his sinless life, death, burial, and resurrection for our sins. And that change in our belief about Jesus should lead to a change in our lives. We now want to please the Lord and not ourselves, out of love for him and what he did for us on the cross. But the scoffers think they can live any way they want. Peter attests to this earlier in chapter 2 when he says that the scoffers, these false teachers, deny the master who bought them. That master who bought them, who redeemed them from the penalty, power, and eventual presence of sin with his death, burial, and resurrection is Jesus Christ. As Lutherans, we don't agree with those of the Reformed faith who believe Jesus only died for the elect. Lutherans believe, teach, and confess that Jesus died for everyone, and that even though the elect are predestined to heaven, unbelievers are not predestined to hell. Jesus paid the price for everyone's sin. He redeemed every one of us, yet we have to believe in him as our Lord and Savior for his pardon to be effective for all eternity. Back in 1830, George Wilson was convicted of robbing the United States Mail from a train, and he was sentenced to be hanged. President Andrew Jackson issued a pardon for Wilson, but Wilson refused to accept it. The matter went to Chief Justice Marshall, who concluded that Wilson would have to be executed. A pardon is a slip of paper, wrote Marshall, the value of which is determined by the acceptance of the person to be pardoned. If it is refused, it is no pardon. George Wilson must be hanged. The Lord doesn't want anyone to be separated from him for all eternity. Peter tells us in verse 9 that the Lord isn't slow. He's patient toward you and me so that everyone can repent and believe Jesus died to pay for their sins. The word patient is very, very interesting. Translated in the King James Version as long-suffering. The Greek word is makrothumia. Macro, large, big, great, thumia, anger, wrath. Better stated, it means God has a very, very, very long fuse. And aren't we glad? Can I get an amen?
Amen.
But when his fuse is lit, things will not be continuing as they have from creation, as the scoffers attest. No, the Lord will come like a thief. Then the heavens will pass away with a roar. The stars and planets will be burned up and dissolved in the earth, and all the works that are done on it will be exposed or laid bare to the fire of God's judgment. The scoffers, who are blots and blemishes, will be taken by surprise. But we as believers should not be. Peter asked the right question in verse 11. Since all these things will be dissolved, what sort of people ought we to be in living lives of holiness and godliness? We're waiting for and hastening the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn. But according to his promise, we're waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Can't wait for that day when his kingdom comes, for sure. In light of the heavens and earth dissolving and new heavens and a new earth, Peter asks, how then should we live? For sure we're to live differently than the scoffers. Peter tells us we're to be diligent to be found by Christ without spot or blemish, and at peace. If we want to experience peace this Advent, even though our world is not peaceful at all, then we need to focus on Christ and become more and more like him. will never be without spot or blemish in this life, but we're to strive to be found by him living a Christ-like life. J.I. Packer, who wrote Knowing God, some of you might have read that, said it best. Those who cope best with pressures and difficulties will ordinarily, whose life quest is to be holy, imitating the Son to the glory of the Father, both with gratitude for the tri-personal love of the Trinity that has brought them from spiritual death to spiritual life, and from a desire to be ready every moment to meet the Lord Jesus and give account to him, should he choose the moment to return or to summon us into his nearer presence. If we want to live and die in peace, holiness is a truth, in truth, a necessity. Now, may we never forget as Lutherans that the Lord is our holiness, our righteousness, and our redemption. Paul says that in 1 Corinthians 1:30. May we remember that holiness is more received than achieved. We are holy because of Christ and his righteousness. So when we do sin, may we confess it, repent immediately, and remember that we've been raised to new life in Christ, and that we have the Holy Spirit who indwells us, who empowers us to live godly, Christ-like lives. And as we behold him, Jesus, we will be transformed from glory to glory, becoming more like him every day. As we know that we are justified by faith in Christ alone and have peace with God, may we not want anyone to perish this Advent and always. While we wait and watch for his return, may we offer everyone that same peace that comes by receiving the gift of God, eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord, always remembering that he shall reign forever and ever. And all God's people say, Amen.
Come on.